Hello everyone, I am Tanvi Kaur and I welcome you to this series called RBI 247. In this very series, we pick up some important financial topics and we try to discuss them with the help of different questions. So for all those who are there for the very first time, you can subscribe to our channel and press this bell icon for all latest updates and notifications. You can also join our Telegram group. In this very group, we share some free quizzes as well as the updates for all our latest videos. So let us move on to question number one, which says RBI has issued norms for dividend distribution by NBFCs. It linked the declaration of dividend by NBFCs to their minimum prudential norms on capital to risk-weighted assets ratio and non-performing assets. RBI has stated the minimum prudential requirements to be eligible to declare the dividend. So which of the following correctly states the net NPA requirement? So recently RBI came up with a notification where it notified some norms which NBFCs have to follow if they want to declare the dividends. So there are certain requirements specified that an NBFC should have this much of CRAR, they should have this much of net NPAs not exceeding this much, and this is required to make sure that NBFCs are strong enough when it comes to maintaining enough capital, when it comes to having assets which are not that very stressed assets. Because if the position of NBFCs is such that it has enough capital, it can deal with the non-performing assets, then only it should utilize its profits to declare dividend. So there are some norms which have been specified. So let us just have a look at this notification first, the directions first, and then we'll answer this question. So as I've already mentioned you that NBFCs have to follow certain new norms if they want to declare the dividends. Alright, and these are related to their capital to risk weighted assets ratio. This we all know, we have been studying about this, that it's the capital adequacy ratio, that how much capital banks should maintain in order to deal with its risky assets. And then the non-performing assets, so certain net NPA ratios should be maintained. Stressed assets, the NPA should not exceed that limit, and if they are exceeding, then the NBFCs should not declare dividends, or they should declare dividends subject to some maximum thresholds. So I'm again saying that these are the norms with respect to declaration of dividends. So you should be clear that what does the word dividend means. The company earns profits, so some portion of profits company retain, and they are used for utilized by the companies to meet their investment opportunities, the growth opportunities they want to invest. So they have that retained money, and money which is not retained, that is distributed in the form of dividends to the shareholders. So whosoever is a shareholder of the company, some portion of the profits is distributed to them and remaining the company retains. So that portion which is distributed is the dividend payout, how much portion company is paying out in the form of dividends. So as I've already mentioned you, RBI has come up with some guidelines. So why has RBI issued these guidelines? Why does it want that NBFCs should follow these norms when it wants to declare dividend? The reason is to bring about a greater amount of transparency and uniformity when it comes to declaration of dividends. And also, suppose there is an NBFC, and that NBFC should act in a conservative manner. That is, if suppose the balance sheet of company is such that it's under significant pressure, it won't be able to deal with the stressed situations. So in that case, the company should conserve capital rather than declaring dividends. Okay, it should not distribute dividends to the shareholders. We have seen recently that RBI allowed some simple policies when it comes to declaration of dividend by different banks. HDFC and other banks, in one of the sessions also I think I discussed that the banks were not going to declare dividends, or less amount of dividends were allowed, especially during this COVID time. Okay, because the banks need to be resilient enough, strong enough, that they have enough capital available to deal with the stressed situations when they come up. So this requirement is necessary for NBFCs also. NBFCs ko bhi zarurat hai ki unke paas enough capital ho jo unhe stress times mein help kare. Agar wo nahi hai to unhe apna sara profit dividend declare karne mein nahi use karna chahiye. Isiliye RBI ne ye guidelines NBFCs ke liye nikali hai. So let us move ahead further now, talking about the applicability of these new norms. So these are applicable to all NBFCs, be it the housing finance companies, core investment companies, mortgage guarantee companies, standalone primary dealers. Then there are NBFCs, peer-to-peer lending platform, account aggregators, systemically important non-deposit taking and deposit taking NBFCs. Then there are non-systemically important non-deposit taking NBFCs. So these things have been discussed in great detail under the NBFC document, which would have been provided to the enrolled students. For non-enrolled ones, you can go through the RBI's website where they talk about NBFCs, different types of NBFCs, different functions of NBFCs. So they have discussed about these NBFCs over there as well. So all these NBFCs are covered under these guidelines, and the date from which this guideline is going to be effective is for the profits for year ending 31st March 2022. So is pure year jo end hoga इस डेट पे तब तक के जो भी प्रॉफिट्स है उनसे अगर डिविडेंड डिक्लेयर करे जाएंगे तो उन पे ये गाइडलाइंस एप्लीकेबल होंगी. नाउ टॉकिंग अबाउट द एलिजिबिलिटी क्राइटेरिया दैट विच एनबीएफसीज कैन डिक्लेयर द डिविडेंड. सो द एनबीएफसीज विच फुलफिल द फॉलोइंग प्रूडेंशियल रिक्वायरमेंट्स दे कैन डिक्लेयर डिविडेंड्स. देन देयर इज ऑल्सो अ थ्रेशोल्ड दैट हाउ मच डिविडेंड कैन बी डिक्लेयर विच आई विल बी डिस्कसिंग इन फर्दर स्लाइड्स. So talking about the minimum prudential requirement with respect to capital adequacy, NBFCs should maintain good enough capital, okay, then only they should go for declaring dividend. So if there is a deposit taking NBFC, okay, other than a standalone primary dealers, they are also a kind of NBFC. We have primary dealers which basically buy and sell your government securities. So some of the subsidiary of banks and some companies are which are considered as NBFC and they carry out this business are these standalone primary dealers. They are a kind of NBFC only. So the deposit taking NBFCs, other than these SPDs, they should have a CRAR of 15% for last 3 years, including year for which you propose to declare a dividend. So 15% CRAR इन्हें maintain करना है. इतना enough capital उनके पास होनी चाहिए जब वो dividend declare करना चाहते हैं. And then there is a kind of NBFC called the housing finance company. For them, the requirement is 13% as on 31st March 2020. Then it will be 14% for 31st March 2021 and 15% on or before 31st March 2022. So, housing finance company ki ye requirement hai. Then I told you that standalone primary dealers mein 15% ki requirement nahi hai. So, for those standalone primary dealers, the requirement of CRAR is a minimum of 20%. Alright. Now talking about net NPA, the NPA should not exceed this much level if the NBFC wants to declare a dividend, and that very threshold is 6%. So agar 6% se kam hai tab NBFC declare kar sakti hai dividend, lekin agar uska net NPA 6% se zyada hai, if its net NPA it is more than 6% in each of the last 3 years, then it should not declare dividend, otherwise it can declare a dividend. And then we have some other criterias also where the NBFCs need to meet certain provisions. For example, the Section 45(1)(c) of Reserve Bank of India Act, okay, and Section 29(c) of National Housing Bank Act. So these sections deal with how much of the reserve fund should be created by an NBFC or by a housing finance company out of its profit before a dividend is declared. So these are some more criterias which the NBFCs need to fulfill if they want to declare a dividend. So I hope the things are clear. Itna unka CRAR hona chahiye, isse zyada unka net NPA nahi hona chahiye, aur ye criteria unhe meet karne chahiye, tabhi wo dividends declare kar sakte hain. Now talking about the maximum thresholds, how much should be the dividend payout ratio? So RBI has issued the guidelines on that also, that how much can be the dividend payout ratio of these NBFCs. Dividend payout ratio is nothing but how much of the profits are used to declare the dividend. So it's the ratio between amount of dividend paid and the net profit for the financial year. So what's the maximum threshold? If there is an NBFC that does not accept the public deposits, then for them there is no ceiling specified. Okay, if they are not accepting public funds, they don't have customer interface, then no ceiling has been specified. But if the NBFC is a core investment company or it's a standalone primary dealer, then in that case the maximum threshold is 60%. So isse zyada ka profit aap dividend ke form mein nahi de sakte, isse kam de sakte ho, but this is the maximum threshold. Then other NBFCs, other than these three specified over here, for them the maximum threshold is 50%. That is 50% of more, not more than 50% of the profits can be used to declare dividends. But there are few points more which are to be noted. where the NBFCs, even if they don't meet the criteria which I discussed, this query criteria and this criteria, then also they can declare a dividend but subject to other conditions. So let us have a look at that. So an NBFC other than SPD, that is the standalone primary dealer, if it is not meeting the eligibility criteria, that is if they are not having enough CRAR which is required, if their net NPA is exceeding the limit or it's not beyond, or it's not meeting the criteria, then also if they want to declare dividend, then they can declare if the following two things are fulfilled. First is that its net NPA should still be less than 4%. Okay, agar wo chalo CRAR nahi meet kar rahe, lekin unko apna jo NPA hai, wo fir unke liye aur dusri requirement hai. That is, pehle tha ki unka 6% se zyada nahi hona chahiye, fir is condition mein aa jayega ki 4% se zyada net NPA nahi hone chahiye. Tab unhe declare karne denge dividend agar wo baki criteria nahi bhi meet kar rahe. लेकिन फिर ये जो लिमिट स्पेसिफाइड थी मैक्सिमम थ्रेशोल्ड, ये एप्लीकेबल नहीं होंगी, बल्कि 10% से ज्यादा वो डिविडेंड पे आउट रेशियो नहीं रख सकते. सो आई एम टेलिंग यू वंस अगेन, एन एनबीएफसी व्हिच डज नॉट फुलफिल द क्राइटेरिया व्हिच आई जस्ट डिस्कस्ड, लाइक दैट ऑफ सीआरएआर एंड अदर क्राइटेरियाज, देन ऑल्सो इट कैन डिक्लेयर डिविडेंड, बट इट्स नेट एनपीए शुड बी लेस देन 4% एंड द मैक्सिमम डिविडेंड पे आउट रेशियो व्हिच इट कैन बेसिकली पे इन द फॉर्म ऑफ डिविडेंड्स इज subject to a maximum cap of 10%. Then talking about standalone primary dealers, which we left in this very point, for them, if they are not meeting the criteria, then also they can declare a dividend. Okay, although their CRAR is less than 20%, but it should be more than 15. Minimum 15 to hona chahiye. Minimum 15, lower than 20, they can still declare the dividends, but dividend payout ratio will not exceed 33.3%. So here you can't get this very maximum, here this 60% threshold will not be applicable. 33.3% is the maximum specified over here. Alright, so let's move back to our question. So the correct answer over here is option C. The net NPA shall be less than 6%, as I just discussed in this very slide. Okay, this 6% thing. Next question is also related to these guidelines only. So let us have a look at it. Which of the following correctly states the maximum threshold of dividend payout ratio for NBFCs that are eligible to declare dividend as per recent RBI direction? So we just discussed, for NBFCs that don't accept public deposits, it's no ceiling. Standalone primary dealers, it's 60%. But for core investment companies also, it's 60%. So this thing 50% is incorrect. So the correct ones are first and third. Answer is option C. Moving on to next question now. So the Reserve Bank prescribed educational qualifications and fit and proper criteria for the managing directors and the whole-time directors of primary urban cooperative banks. Which of the following criteria is incorrect? So recently RBI has come up with some directions where it tells that for urban cooperative banks, what's the criteria for the appointment of the managing directors and that of the whole time directors. So let's just discuss that notification first and then we'll move back to our question. RBI ne kuch guidelines jari ki hai ki managing director appoint karna hai aur whole time director appoint karna hai, to uske liye मैनेजर एमडी और WTD को ये एजुकेशनल क्वालिफिकेशंस होनी चाहिए, ये उसका टेन्योर होना चाहिए. सो लेट अस डिस्कस दोज गाइडलाइंस. फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल, मैनेजिंग डायरेक्टर आल्सो डेजिग्नेटेड एट टाइम्स एज अ चीफ एग्जीक्यूटिव ऑफिसर, सो ही इज अ पर्सन हु इज इंटरेस्टेड विद द मैनेजमेंट ऑफ द होल अफेयर्स ऑफ अर्बन कोऑपरेटिव बैंक. अर्बन कोऑपरेटिव बैंक का जो पूरा मैनेजमेंट देखेगा वो एमडी होता है, एंड ही विल फंक्शन अंडर द डायरेक्शन एंड कंट्रोल ऑफ द बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स. अदर देन दैट, अनदर डेजिग्नेशन विच वी हैव इज दैट ऑफ अ होल टाइम डायरेक्टर, एंड ही विल बी परफॉर्मिंग अदर मैनेजमेंट फंक्शंस विच आर डिसाइडेड बाय द बोर्ड ऑफ डायरेक्टर्स, एंड द होल टाइम डायरेक्टर विल रिपोर्ट टू द मैनेजिंग डायरेक्टर विच हैज बीन अपॉइंटेड टू टेक केयर ऑफ whole affairs of the urban cooperative banks. So now we'll be discussing what should be the qualifications of an MD and of a WTD. So if they are to be appointed, then a fit and proper criteria has been specified for them by RBI. And the first one relates to their qualifications. So if I talk about their educational qualifications, the educational qualifications include that the person should be a graduate either in banking or cooperative banking, or he should have a diploma in banking, in finance, in business management, or any other equivalent qualification. Or he can also be a chartered accountant, a cost accountant, or having an MBA in finance. Thirdly, he can also have a post-graduation in any discipline. So this is the educational criteria which has been specified for a person to be appointed as a MD or a WTD. Second is the age limits. Okay, so if I talk about the age, the person should not be below 35 years and not above 70 years. So this is the criteria. Third is related to the experience. So if I talk about the experience of a person, then 8 year experience is needed, at least 8 year experience as a at a middle or a senior management level in any banking sector or non-banking finance company which deals in lending, in giving loans, in asset financing. Okay, and the last is with respect to what a person shall not be. ये कुछ चीजें हैं, अगर person इनमें से कुछ है तो वो MD या WTD नहीं बन सकता. So they include that he is engaged in any other business, or he is having some position as a member of parliament, state legislature or municipality and all, or he is a director in other company other than Section 8 companies, or he is a partner of some other firm or having substantial interest in other company, or he is a director, MD, पार्टनर ऑफ एनी ट्रेडिंग कमर्शियल फर्म. सो अगर वो कोई और टाइप का बिजनेस कर रहा है, किसी और फर्म में डायरेक्टर है, किसी और फर्म में उसका सब्सटैंशियल इंटरेस्ट है, तब वो पर्सन WTD या MD नहीं बनेगा अर्बन कोऑपरेटिव बैंक का. सो इफ अ पर्सन इज इनटू अदर बिजनेस हैविंग सब्सटैंशियल इंटरेस्ट इन अदर फर्म, MD पार्टनर ऑफ अदर फर्म, देन ही कैन नॉट बिकम MD और WTD ऑफ दिस वेरी अर्बन कोऑपरेटिव बैंक. फॉर ओवर ही शुड नॉट बी ऑफ अनसाउंड माइंड, ही शुड नॉट बी डिस्चार्ज्ड एज इनसॉल्वेंट. He should not be convicted by court as for doing some kind of an offense, and he should not be a director of any other cooperative bank and all. So these are some things. If person falls under these categories, then he cannot be a WTD or a managing director. All right. Now talking about their tenure, so person can be appointed for a max of 5 years, and then he is also eligible for reappointment. So the person cannot hold the post of MD or WTD for a period of more than 15 years. So 5 years is the tenure, then he can be reappointed up till 15 years. But if he further wants to be reappointed after that, then a 3 year cooling period is must. All right. And if an urban cooperative bank decides that it wants to terminate the services of MD or WTD before the expiry of this tenure, then it needs an approval from RBI's end. Okay. Then we also have a very important role of the nomination and remuneration committee over here. So urban cooperative banks will constitute this committee. This committee will make sure that the proper criteria which has been specified is actually met when a person is being appointed. So it will undertake the process of due diligence to determine if a person is fitting as per this criteria to be a MD or WTD. Secondly, on completion of the process of due diligence, it will shortlist the candidates and tell the board about the shortlisted candidates for MD or WTD. It will recommend their remuneration. It will pass a resolution for forwarding the names of persons from the panel recommended by NRC for appointment. So, unka appointment, unka remuneration, ye committee bhi dekhti hai. And then we have the termination of MD or WTD by Urban Cooperative Bank. You can do so before the tenure, but RBI approval is needed and you need to specify the reasons why you want to terminate their services beforehand only. So these were the guidelines which I wanted to discuss. Now moving back to our question, the incorrect statement over here is only option B, because it was 35 years and 70 years. Remaining two are correct. Okay, so the answer is option B. Moving on to last question now, which says, which of the following statement correctly relates with positive multiplier effects that justify interest rate cuts and liquidity accommodation? So we know that the current monetary policy which is being followed is an accommodative stance where RBI is keeping the interest rates low. It is trying to increase the liquidity in the economy so that economy can recover from this pandemic situation. So there have been questions about lower interest rates impacting the savers. कि lower interest rates होते हैं तो उनसे savers को नुकसान है क्योंकि उनको high interest rates नहीं मिलते अपनी deposits पे. So there is basically this belief that if the interest rates are low, then people will not keep deposits in bank because those savers are not going to get higher interest rates. But what RBI experts say that even if the interest rates are low, the savers can benefit. Now, how they can benefit, that I am going to discuss now. Recently, when our monetary policy decision was taken, then there were experts' views also shared. Okay, if you go through the RBI website, what different experts have to say, you will find that they say that savers who are looking for higher interest rate, okay, they might lose on when it comes to keeping the deposits and earning interest on them, but still they will save a lot or they will gain a lot because of higher economic activity which will prevail due to these low interest rates. So for this, the RBI experts basically quote some economic models. Okay, we don't have to get into the details of that model, but I just discussed that in very brief that what our experts have to say. So RBI's executive director Mridul Sagar, he says that the argument that lower interest rate hurts savers does not hold. How it does not hold for this? He gave talked about a model called heterogeneous agents new Keynesian model, which provide us a reason to think that not all savers may necessarily be worse off when central banks push down their interest rates. So what do these models say? These models capture the additional effects that are heterogeneous. We don't have to get into the details of the model, but when one decision is taken, then it will have some other heterogeneous effects also, which might prove out to be positive. So let's see what's the positive side of low interest rates. So if interest rates provide an opportunity for more output, job generation, thereby making up for the loss in the interest income. Let us see how this happens. अगर interest rates low है, तो लोग ज़्यादा borrow कर पाएंगे. लोग ज़्यादा borrow करेंगे, तो money supply basically economy में increase होगा. जिससे कि लोग के पास borrow करने के बाद पैसा ज़्यादा आएगा, तो demand भी increase होगी. Demand बढ़ेगी, तो production बढ़ेगी. Production बढ़ेगी, तो लोगों को ज़्यादा jobs मिलेंगी. Jobs मिलेंगी, तो उनको wages मिलेंगी. उनको salaries मिलेंगी. So आपने देखा कैसे low interest rates ने compensate कर दिया जो नुकसान हो सकता था savers को deposits पे. How? By making sure that they earn more in the form of wages and salaries. Okay, thus compensated for a drop in interest incomes on savings. So if interest rates are low, people can borrow more. More money supply in the economy, more demand, more production, more production, more wages, more because there are more jobs also. So people will get compensated for low interest rates in the form of more salaries and wages because of generation of job once the demand is stimulated in the economy. So with a large proportion of low income and other liquidity constrained households in India, these indirect second round effects could be very significant. Now talking about this further, so savers might be worse off if their savings are in fixed income instruments. However, in the middle of the shock, there is a strong case to keep interest rates low because of the benefits which they offer. One benefit is helps individuals and firms that were liquidity constrained. So there are firms, there are individuals which might be suffering because they don't have enough funding available. So liquidity constraints will go away when more money flows into the economy in the form of low interest rates. Agar interest rates kam honge to log zyada borrow kar payenge, to unke paas agar paison ki kami thi, funding nahi thi, to wo meet kar sakte hain aur apna business ya jis purpose ke liye unhe paisa chahiye wo borrow kar sakte hain. Secondly, public debt created through physical expansion becomes more sustainable if interest rates are low. We are seeing that government needs to borrow because it needs to make expenditure. So if interest rates are low, it can borrow at low rates. So that's the another benefit. And thirdly, as I have just discussed through the diagram in the previous slides, that it can help economy to recover by increasing money supply, stimulating investment, spending, production, output, the very thing related to how it will generate more jobs and income for the people. So these multiplier effects justify the rate cuts and the liquidity accommodation. If I move back to the question, we had to identify the correct statements which show the positive effects of low interest rates. So first is correct that it helps individual in that were liquidity constraints. Second, it says public debt created through physical expansion becomes sustainable. This is correct. Third is not correct. It doesn't help in reducing money supply but in increasing. So first and second are correct. Answer is option B. This was all for today's session. I hope you found the session to be useful. With this, I would like to end up this session. Thank you so much.